Hi, this is Annie Dance. I'm an independent investigative journalist working to shine a light on police and policy issues in Lake Lore, Western North Carolina, and beyond. Please subscribe if you haven't already to AnnieDance.substack.com, my Cops and Congress newsletter. Today, Tuesday, June 4th, 2024, at the North Carolina General Assembly, the Senate Judiciary Committee is about to begin. They are going on their agenda that at least they have certain issues they will discuss, including death by distribution, Good Samaritan autopsy. So let's see what they have to say with today at the NCGA. It is scheduled to begin in just a moment, and you may view further details on ncleg.gov. Go into the committee folder and view it from there. So there's been some things in the news about this, and it's unclear to me right now exactly where things stand. We hope to get more details from the lawmakers themselves. And just a side note, or if you recall from my previous videos, the North Carolina General Assembly does not archive their videos. So I'm hoping to bridge that gap. Please also follow me on social media for the latest updates at Annie M. Dance on X, formerly Twitter, and Facebook are where I post the most information. Again, AnnieDance.substack.com. I greatly appreciate your support as I work to shine a light on these important issues. With today at the NCGA, we will begin in just a moment.
Cavanaugh, Mr. Dean Gustafson, Ms. Cherie Hedrick, Mr. Chris Moore, and Mr. Michael Norton. We also have several pages with us today. If you would please step to the mic, state your name and who you are sponsored by.
My name is Oren Klein, and I'm sponsored by Senator Proctor.
My name is Jackson Ferris, and I'm sponsored by Senator Overcash.
My name is Eli Hardison. I'm from Clinton, and I'm sponsored by Senator Jackson.
My name is Hampton Jones. I'm from Charlotte, North Carolina, and my sponsor is Senator Berger.
Hi, I'm Kylie Reynolds. I'm from Fayetteville, and my sponsor is Senator Applewhite.
Hi, I'm Evie Tellis, and my sponsor is Senator Sanderson.
I'm Taylor Ward, and my sponsor is Senator Berger.
Senator Bodie?
I think these pagers have done an excellent job. Well done.
Thank you. First up, we're going to go a little bit out of order. We're going to go Senate Bill 802 first, CPACE program. I believe Senator Newton, you moved to have this on for discussion only. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And the PCS is before us. Sorry, there's no PCS, but it is discussion only.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. We have Senate Bill 802, which is a CPACE program for discussion today. It's been through Commerce. Basically, it establishes the Commercial Property Assessment Capital Expenditure Program that 30-plus states offer, and it's to go through it, the program will be administered under the oversight of the Department of Commerce, and as we have it, EDPNC will actually be the applying agency. Under the program, property owners and qualifying commercial property could apply to EDPNC to be approved for long-term financing provided by private lenders to pay for property improvements that would include a lot of energy efficient programs, water conservation, renewables, and resiliency measures. Essentially, it's part of a capital stack. It's a tool in the toolbox that the state could offer at its own will in the individual counties and or cities to offer this financing package. And essentially what it does is whatever the improvements are The municipalities will create an assessment based on that value, and therefore drives the cost of money in that middle capital stack down. There's no public funds that are involved in this. It's clearly capital that's offered by lenders, and many of the benefits are promotes efficiencies and in capital programs in the areas that I discussed earlier. Creates liens that are secured. It creates long-term financing options for those that are entering in those agreements, up to 20 to 30 year amortization schedules that have fixed payments, fixed interest rates, and therefore make it an affordable part of their complete portfolio, or what we will call the capital stack of a particular project. I'll be glad to answer any questions. Again, this is a tool in the toolbox that this state currently does not have, and there are 30 plus states in the country that do have this as part of their programs within the state. And essentially, if you have a developer that comes, that wants to come to your state, that utilizes this sort of financing in other areas, we certainly don't want to be the state that says, I'm sorry, we don't have it. You can go to Tennessee or other areas that may have it. We think it's a great program. We think it's something that municipalities and counties can utilize at their choosing. It's very technical in nature and hard to understand, but essentially this program allows for, in that middle stack, the lower cost of money within that for those programs, for those resiliency projects, you know, portion of that project, and it's just makes it easy to do for certain projects. This is not for everyone. A lot of details in here. You have to have five or more already existing properties. There's a lot of details that comes along with it. I'm sure there may be some technical questions that you may have. Senator Lee's here with me. We've worked on this together. A lot of legalese involved here, but be glad to answer any questions.
Any questions from members of the committee? As Senator Sanderson, Senator Gailey, Senator Marcus.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Senator Lazara, I'm sure it's going to either be covered by already existing statute or something that's in this, and I haven't had a chance to read through it that well. What are the consequences in that happen in case of a default on one of these, I guess, loan programs, if that's what it is?
Thank you, Senator Sanderson. It is secured by a lien, and of course, tax liens always takes precedence, so it'll go through the normal process. You're going to have, everyone has to approve this package. In other words, if there's an existing building, the first lien holder is going to have to approve it. Everyone has to approve this typical financing package. So there's no public funds. It goes through the regular process based on that particular situation and who would take interest, whether the first lender would buy out the second lender, you know, the second interest. So it just varies on the project.
Thank you, sir.
And Senator Gailey.
I think you just answered my question, but just to triple check to be sure I understand it, that if there is a tax lien, whether it's prior or subsequent to the, I guess, CPACE lien, that would take priority. Is that right?
That's correct.
Thank you.
Senator Marcus.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair. I like this program because I think it's going to encourage energy efficiency upgrades and resiliency work, which I think is an important goal. I support the bill. I think this is the appropriate committee, though, to have staff address. I think Mr. Patterson is prepared to address the opinion of the state treasurer, that this is apparently, in his opinion, unconstitutional. I don't see it. I don't understand that, but I thought it would be appropriate for us to address that concern and address how this program differs from a program such as like a private school voucher money going that, and how that is different. And staff could address that now. I think that'd be helpful.
Mr. Chairman, I can actually address that if that's okay.
Senator Lee.
I think the opportunity scholarships are based to improve the lives of children and families, and this really relates to business and economic development. And so the treasurer's office reached out to me and said that they thought it might be unconstitutional. Wasn't entirely sure what the basis was of the claim. I assume it was on an emoluments issue. I don't think it's an issue under the federal emoluments clause. I don't think it's an issue under the state emoluments clause based on the Town of Surf City case and the two-prong test because there's a public benefit.
Senator Marcus, follow-up. And Senator Lee, could you spell that word for Senator Daniel?
I can abbreviate it.
Any other questions? Any other questions? Like I said, it's a very technical, complicated bill, but it's done in 30 plus states. You're welcome to do the research on it. And it's a really good tool in the toolbox for those developers that do large scale projects. This is not for
Senator Newton.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Senator Lee and Lazar. I look forward to a little further conversation in addition to the question I want to ask here. Are there any minimums or maximums of the scale or the scope of the projects that this would apply to?
Senator Lee?
So I think what you're asking is are there any minimums or maximums for the total project cost, whether new construction or renovation? And then maybe the other is whether there's an LTV minimum or maximum. Is that?
Yes. Yes.
So generally speaking, no. And so this deals with two different types of projects. One, you have new construction. The other type of project is a renovation. Maybe it's a new roof. Maybe it's bringing your structure up to code because it was constructed prior to certain hurricane codes for resiliency perspective and some of those things, or maybe it's a flooding issue. Generally speaking, the projects that will be subject to CPACE are those in which are the transactional costs are likely those that will create their own minimums as far as the total project cost. The maximums would likely be very high because these projects are utilized in some very large projects, whether it's a multifamily project, manufacturing facility, or office building or things like that. From an LTV perspective, I think Senator Lazar was talking about this being a portion of the capital stack. Typically, it's going to be between 10 and 30%. Of what we've seen in other states. There's a reference to 100% financing in some materials. I think that relates to something different rather than 100% financing of the entire project. I think it means that it becomes financeable with a combination of this piece of the capital stack and also the financing. If someone's got the traditional bank lending, so traditional bank lending, this middle piece of capital, lower cost capital, and then equity. And sometimes you can phase out the equity to smaller numbers. So that's the long answer. The short answer is no, there's not, but I think there's some practical and structural things that provide those.
Thank you. Another question. Thank you. That does help me a lot, Senator Lee. I appreciate it. Would this kind of program apply to wetland mitigation projects potentially?
So I think there are a lot of questions on what it would apply to, and I think the best way to answer, if short answer is no. But if on page 2, a qualifying improvement is a permanent improvement that's affixed to a qualifying commercial property, includes one or more of the following, and that's what Senator Lazar was talking about, an energy efficiency measure, resiliency, or renewable energy measure.
It has to be a fixture, a permanent fixture.
Did I hear it has to be a fixture? Is that what I thought I heard that?
Yeah. HVAC, insulation, encapsulating buildings for water intrusion, those sorts of improvements.
Follow-up, Senator Newton?
Would storm resiliency improvements qualify?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Any other questions or comments on Senate Bill 802?
Mr. Chairman, and that to finish that answer, it's providing that it's a permanent improvement. Yes.
Any other questions or comments from members of the committee or the audience? Again, that was on for discussion only. We will meet again tomorrow at 2 p.m. Where the bill will be voted. Next up, we have House Bill 495. I believe Senator Newton has a technical amendment on House Bill 495. It is H 495 ACE 123, and it just fixes a typo. Have a motion.
I move to amend the bill.
Motion from Senator Newton to amend the bill. All in favor say aye. All opposed. PCS is back before us again. This was PCS we discussed last meeting. There was no comments from committee, no comments from folks in the audience. If we have a motion for a favor, Senator Newton, I mean, Daniel moves for Senator Daniel.
Move to amend the bill. Move to consider the PCS. All right, so love being volunteered for this.
Yeah, yeah, 495.
All right, so I move for favorable report to the PCS for 495 as amended, rolled into a new PCS unfavorable to the original with a referral to the Senate Rules Committee.
Have a motion for favorable. No further discussion on House Bill 495. Senator Daniel moves for a favorable report for the PCS for House Bill 495 as amended, rolled into a new PCS unfavorable to the original bill with a referral to Senate Rules. All in favor say aye. All opposed. The ayes have it. Next, we'll move on to House 250. This bill has two amendments. Senator Newton.
All right. Thank you, committee, for allowing me to temporarily take over the gavel. Senator. Somebody's tapping. Yes. Do I have a motion for the PCS to be back before the committee? So move. Senator Sanderson, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All right, the PCS is back before us. Senator Britt, do you have an amendment?
Yes, Amendment H250 ACE 124, version 11. This amendment is the language that was worked on between the Department of Health and Human Services Medical Examiner's Office, as well as Conference of DAs, resolving the differences they had on the bill. It also removes a provision related to the release of autopsy reports to the media. There is an additional provision that allows for someone with a second or subsequent DWI within 7 years to be able to get a limited driving privilege, which they can't do now. However, they have to get an interlock placed on their car if they get the limited driving privilege. Currently, there's no pathway for them to get a limited driving privilege. They cannot drive at all legally. So essentially, a lot of these folks, especially in rural areas where there's no public transit or driving anyway, we worked on this and discussed this with Mothers Against Drug Driving and other organizations. Know of no opposition. And again, this would be individuals who have no grossly aggravating factors and are low-level DWIs with marginal blows.
Questions from the committee about the provisions of the amendment? Seeing none, all those in favor of the amendment, please indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? The ayes have it. Bill PCS as amendment is back before. Senator Britt, do you have another amendment?
I do not, but I believe Senator Lazar does.
Senator Lazar does. I apologize. Senator Lazar?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have Amendment H250-ACE-121, version 3, essentially adding death by distribution of xylazine. Xylazine is a new chemical that's been being distributed that we have had a lot of overdoses in relation to that. It's a horse tranquilizer that is being mixed in drug users. And unfortunately, Narcan does not work on this particular chemical, and we've had a lot of deaths as a result of this. And we'd ask for your support.
Thank you, Senator Lazar. Questions from the committee on the amendment? Not seeing any. All those in favor of the amendment, please indicate by saying aye. Aye. Any opposed? The ayes have it. The bill as amended again is back before us. Committee members, is there further discussion, questions as to this bill as amended? Senator Newton is recognized first, and then Senator Muhammad.
Just a curiosity question. So we're amending the bill to add xylazine, which is a new emerging compound. Did you all talk about a way to amend the bill so that we capture even newer emerging compounds that are, you know, harmful to the public?
Senator Lazar, you want to take that first?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Yes, we have discussed that. This is the what we would call the newest compound that is being distributed. There's other areas that we are working in a separate bill that is not included in this bill that you'll see coming forward that will address a lot of the hemp products and other products, or what we're going to call gas station heroin, that will be included in a separate bill. But this brings us up to date with the compounds and chemicals that we know that are being distributed, and that's what we have before us today.
Gotcha. So follow up. Good, Mr. Chairman. So I appreciate that. It feels like maybe constitutionally we're going to be in a place where we have to amend the bill every time there's a named drug. It's hard to get a catch-all that's not unconstitutional, perhaps. I don't know, and I don't mean to debate that here or discuss it here, but I just appreciate the effort and fully supportive. Thanks.
Thank you, Senator Newton. And I would add that, you know, we have addressed in this committee other bills that deal with similar new substances and issues, an embalming fluid bill, for example, if you may recall from last session, which hopefully will be completed this session, and other things. So it is an ongoing effort. So, Senator Muhammad, you still have a question?
Yes, Mr.
You recognize.
Question for the bill sponsor or staff. I wanted to ask, I'm no expert when it comes to autopsies or anything, but what happens when, is there any type of language in here about type of personal, religious, or family exceptions if the family personally doesn't want to wait 72 hours to proceed with funeral services? And the district attorney's given notice?
Yeah, there's nothing addressed in the bill about that.
Follow up. I would...
Hey, hang on just a second. Staff, is there anything you wish to add, Robert? Yes. Go ahead, Senator Muhammad, follow up.
Thank you. So, follow-up, Senator Britt, one thing I just suggested, because I know many faiths sometimes can't wait to proceed with funeral services, and some families might have personal situations that come up where they might want that. So you might want to look into an exception in your bill to allow that for family members.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think that would be something that would be that would cause too much consternation. If you could maybe speak to Chuck's Bay Hospital, Conference of DAs, and we'll circle up and see what we can maybe do on the floor. This is going over to the House as well. We don't know whether they'll concur with everything that's in here quite yet. So it's possible there'll be some changes at conference anyway.
Okay.
So we've got some runway.
Thank you, Senator.
All right. Thank you, Senator Mahan. Are there other questions or comments from the committee? All right. Let's see if I can remember without my cheat sheet. Probably not. Chair will entertain a motion. And that would be a motion for a favorable report to the PCS for H-250 as amended, rolled into a new PCS unfavorable to the original bill with a referral to Senate rules with permission for staff to make technical changes and corrections. Senator Lazar so moves. Any further discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? The ayes have it. And the bill passes. And I believe that concludes our agenda for today. So we are adjourned.
There you have it today at the NCGA Judiciary Committee. Thanks for watching.